And thank you for coming back out on a Sunday evening to study what I think is a most interesting topic. It's kind of interesting that I'm dealing with this on Sunday evening. We have a Bible study on biblical archaeology going on Wednesday night that is dealing with some of the same issues. And some of this stuff, I'll just warn you, is kind of difficult to wade through. And in some of these introductory messages, we've looked at two of them already, and we'll look at one more tonight, and hopefully we'll get through it. And, you know, I've really got some good news and bad news tonight. The good news is that next Sunday night, we're going to begin actually an exposition of the text, and we're going to be talking about in the beginning what that means. And then the bad news is, for tonight at least, we've got one more of these introductory lessons that really is more like a lecture than it is a sermon. But it's vital for me to lay this groundwork to go where I'm going and for you to understand the perspective that I'm coming from. And tonight I only want to read one verse of Scripture to start off, and that, again, is Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1 as we are in this series, Confusion Over Creation. And you know that verse by heart. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Can you think of a verse of Scripture anywhere else, or even a statement anywhere else, where more truth is packed in such an economy of words than what we find in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1, that in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth? Now, I think it was the last time that we were together, because we were out Labor Day weekend last Sunday, but I think the last time that we were together, I told you that I am a young earther, which means that I believe that the universe is somewhere between 6 to 10,000 years old. And tonight what I want to do is I want to kind of let you get into my brain. I'm not much up there to get into, but get into my brain and see why it is that I have arrived at this conclusion, when there are a lot of people who have arrived at a very different conclusion. It's important for you to understand, as your pastor, why it is that I believe what I believe about the age of the universe. Now, you know, the bottom line is probably most Christians could care less. You know, whether it's 10 billion years old or 10,000 years old, most could care less. I mean, most would say, hey, God did it. God created it. That's all that matters. But there are those that apologetics, man, I want to tell you, that's what butters their bread. And they like that. I'll be up front. I don't. I would much rather just be preaching through a book of the Bible. Apologetics is, that's not my cup of tea. And yet, give to you the whole counsel of God, I think I'm responsible for doing that. But as I said last week, there are many, many people that do not agree with me when it comes to the age of the universe. And I certainly respect their right to disagree with me. And I think that I went out of my way, or at least I tried to go out of my way, to tell you that there are a lot of people that are old earthers that believe that the universe is billions of years old, who love God just as much as I do, have been born again just like I'm born again, saved by the grace of God, just like I am saved by the grace of God. And so I went out of my way, because what's important to me as I'm dealing with this topic is for this not to be a divisive issue in our fellowship. And it never should be a divisive issue. Can I get a witness? It never should divide the body of Christ. And so if you are an old earther, and this causes division between you and I, you're the one that has the problem, not me, because I don't have a problem with you. And so if you've got a problem with this, then it's something that you have created and not me. But what I hope that you will see is that here is a subject that I have thought sincerely, seriously, and as deeply as my little mind will allow me to come up with the conclusion that I have arrived at. It's not something that I've just simply thrown out in the air and said, you know, this is what I believe. No, I believe what I believe, but I want to show you that there are reasons that I believe what I believe. And the primary issue for me when it comes to the dating of the universe and me being a young earther, the primary issue for me is an issue of authority. Everything to me boils down to what is my authority in determining the issue about the age of the universe. Now, would you not agree that perceived authority pretty much dictates everything in life that we do? I mean, the football team runs the plays that the coach sends in because the football team perceives that the coach is their authority. You know, the preschooler does what mom and dad says to do eventually because mom and dad are the perceived authority. You go to work at 7 o'clock in the morning because your employer says you need to be here by 7 o'clock and your employer is the perceived authority. And I really believe that when it comes to dating the universe, the reason I date it like I do is because of what I perceive to be my authority. So authority is the whole issue to me. Now, some are very comfortable in synthesizing various authorities when it comes to dating the universe. And you know what? They may be correct as they synthesize those various authorities. But as for me personally, I'm just simply not comfortable in doing that. Many old earthers are what we refer to as progressive creationists. That is, they believe God did it, but they believe that God did it over long periods of time, like billions of years. And I do not believe that. I believe in progressive revelation. I believe that God revealed himself to man in steps and in different ways at different times. For example, in the book of Hebrews chapter number 1, verses 1 and 2, the Bible tells us that when it says that God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, but he has in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. That is progressive revelation. But I do not believe in progressive creation, because to believe in progressive creation, what you actually have to believe in is a dual authority. There is general revelation, which is what? God revealing himself in nature. And then there is special revelation, which is what? God revealing himself in Scripture. Now both of these are true. God has revealed himself both in general revelation and in special revelation. In fact, if I were to say that God has not revealed himself in nature, you could label me as a heretic, because we know God has done that. And yet the bottom line for me is that when it comes to general revelation and special revelation, does one trump the other? Does one have authority over the other? Or are both of them on equal footing? And that is really the line of demarcation for me. And so that's kind of where we're headed tonight. We're going to talk about this idea of general revelation versus special revelation, and does one have authority over another. And tonight I want to ask and try to answer a couple of questions that I believe are extremely significant in how you're going to determine the age of the universe. And yet I want to close with a concluding question, which will kind of clarify everything that I've said. So first of all, the first question that I want to raise and that I want to try to answer is this. Should we appraise Scripture by science, or should we appraise science by Scripture? Should we appraise Scripture by science, or should we appraise science by Scripture? And to me, this is a key issue that in the end will have a lot to say about how we date the universe. As a matter of fact, in my opinion, this is absolutely foundational to our topic. Just like everything that we believe, there is a foundation for that belief. And I believe the foundation for my belief as to how I date the universe is wrapped up in how I answer that one question: do I appraise Scripture by science, or do I praise science by Scripture? One of the leading evangelical figures today who seeks to harmonize the Genesis account of creation with modern scientific theories is a man by the name of Dr. Hugh Ross. Dr. Hugh Ross is a brilliant man. I've often thought if somehow I could just run a tube from his brain to mine and suck over some of his brilliance into my mind, how blessed that I would be. But he's an extremely brilliant man. He is a former astrophysicist who is now a full-time apologist, and he's an advocate of old Earth creationism. Dr. Ross uses the term that I mentioned earlier, progressive creationism, to describe the entirety of his views. And to his credit, he affirms without reservation the absolute authority and the inerrancy of Scripture. He accepts the biblical testimony that God created each species of living creature individually. He does not believe that lower life forms evolved into higher ones or that humans evolved from animal species. He regards Adam and Eve as historical figures, the literal parents of the human race. Because of these beliefs, his position is far, far superior to those of the theistic evolutionist or other professing Christians who hold to evolutionary theory and end up concluding that the early chapters of Genesis are merely myth or error. And unlike those folks that I've just mentioned who are liberal, Dr. Hugh Ross is not a liberal. I believe that he is an evangelical, just like we are. As a matter of fact, the doctrinal statement of his ministry publishes a straightforward statement concerning his evangelical convictions. And he and I have so very much in common. We completely agree on the essential doctrines of the faith. Both of us would say that we are saved by grace through faith plus nothing. Both of us would say that we believe in the inerrancy of the Word of God. Both of us would say that we believe that there is a literal heaven and there is also a literal hell. And I bring all of this up because as I cite some of his beliefs tonight, I don't want you to think that I'm accusing him of being a liberal. I'm going to quote him tonight, but I'm not quoting him to blast him, but I'm quoting him for the simple reason that he is one, if not the leading authority of progressive creationism. And since I do not believe in progressive creationism, then I'm obviously compelled to quote his work and to tell you why it is that I disagree with it so that you can understand why I, as your pastor, believe what I believe about the age of the universe. And even though my brother, Dr. Ross, and I would agree on so many things that I've just mentioned, there is one point where we leave one another, and that point where we leave one another produces a different interpretation of the Genesis account of creation. Dr. Ross has accepted and embraced selected theories of Big Bang cosmology, which he regards as undisputed fact, including the idea that the universe and the earth are billions of years old, and therefore what he ends up doing is he employs those theories as lenses through which to interpret the Scripture. So obviously we can't arrive at the same conclusion because we began with a different presupposition. He would believe that you would look through at Scripture through the lens of science, and I would say that you would look at science through the lens of Scripture. And you see, for me to do what this brilliant Christian man does, personally, I would feel that I was making the Scripture subservient to science and would, for all practical purposes, I would be replacing the Scripture with another source as my authority. And I just personally live with the conviction that if there is anything that I look to as a greater source of authority than just simply the naked Word of God, then it is going to get me in trouble as a preacher of the Word of God. And you see, Dr. Ross, he's just as convinced as I am about his beliefs. He thinks that he's right, just like I think that I'm right. And it's okay for the two of us as brothers to disagree. He's convinced that modern scientific theory can give us superior understanding to the basic facts related to the origin of the universe. And I'm not. Now, let me give you that again, because sometimes I can just give you a whole lot of stuff and it slips right by. But here is a major difference. He is convinced that modern scientific theory can give us superior understanding of the basic facts related to the origin of the universe. And I am not convinced of that. He argues, in effect, that the findings of modern science are necessary to interpret the Bible's true meaning. According to Dr. Ross, thanks to the evolutionist Big Bang theory, that our generation is now able to understand the true meaning of biblical creation, the narratives. We can understand them in a way that previous generations could not, because we have, listen, an understanding of scientific theory they did not have. He believes that modern scientific opinion about the age and the origin of the universe is essential to explain what Scripture really meant all along. Now, carried to its logical conclusion, this would mean that all past generations, from Moses through the 20th century, have been clueless as to the true meaning of the Genesis account of creation, because they did not have the extra biblical resources that we have in our day. And so Dr. Hugh Ross, what he ends up doing, in my personal opinion, is putting too much stock in general revelation. I believe in general revelation, God revealing himself through nature. But I don't want to skew that out of the proportion that I believe the Scripture teaches us, that the proportion that we should keep that particular revelation in. And one of the struggles that I have with Dr. Ross's beliefs is that when you read his books, it seems that he uses a rather arbitrary method of determining which doctrines of modern science should be regarded as fact and which are simply theory. When you read his books, you'll find these two statements over and over again: the latest research or the latest data. And it's almost as if the research and the data that's comprised by man is unquestionable fact. And that's a struggle for me. For example, the Big Bang theory that is highly controversial, even among Ross's fellow astronomers, is something that he believes in. It's the when we talk about the Big Bang theory, what is that? Well, it's a theory. You know, it's just the latest in a long line of scientific explanations as to how the universe came to be. And Big Bang cosmology itself, you know, it's in a constant flux. And yet, despite all the uncertainty surrounding the Big Bang, he regards it, and I quote, as an unshakably established fact. You read that in his book, The Fingerprint of God. And he insists that Big Bang sheds necessary light on the true meaning of the book of Genesis and the creation account. He also advocates a scheme of long paleontological eras that he says harmonizes perfectly with the 6 days of creation. Well, the only way that it could harmonize perfectly with the 6 days of creation is to view the Scripture through the lens of science and make them long periods rather than a literal 6-day creation account. To maintain his view, he's faced with obviously some difficulties right out of the box. For example, if plant life appears on day 3, like the Bible says, and the sun, that is essential to sustaining those plants, does not appear until day 4, and we have no idea how much time is between day 3 and day 4, how in the world is plant life sustained? And yet we find these problems coming up, in my opinion, with that theory over and over again, and yet they seem to remain unanswered. My problem is the narrowing of the line between questionable theories and indisputable facts. You see, he believes that science has proven irrefutably that the flood of Noah's era could not really have been the sort of worldwide deluge that, at least to me, a literal reading of Genesis chapter 7, verses 19 through 24 would indicate. What leads him to that view? It is the way that he looks at the Scripture. He views the Scripture through science. Friend, listen, when we look at the Genesis account of the flood, and we just read that just for what it says, and we look at nothing else. Remember what we've said over and over again in our church about Bible interpretation, that if the literal sense makes good sense. Seek no other sense, lest it lead to nonsense. And when you read that account, for example, look in Genesis chapter 7 for a moment. Genesis chapter 7, and look at verse number 19. Genesis chapter 7, and look at verse number 19. And if you're just, you know, sitting down reading this, you know, your mind is not being impacted by any other resource. You know, what would you think when you read, "And the waters prevailed exceedingly upon the earth, and all the high hills that were under the whole heaven were covered. 15 cubits upward did the waters prevail, and the mountains were covered, and all flesh died that moved upon the earth, both of fowl and cattle and beast and every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth and every man. And in all and all in whose nostrils was the breath of life, of all that was in the dry land died, and every living substance was destroyed which was upon the face of the ground, both man and cattle and creeping thing, the fowl of the heaven, they were all destroyed from the earth, and Noah only remained alive, and they that were with him in the ark, and the waters prevailed upon the earth 150 days. The earth, the earth, the earth, the earth, the earth, over and over and over again. All, over and over again. And to me, as just kind of a simple-minded guy, when I read that, I mean, the literal sense to me says that here was an event that happened over the entire globe. It was not just a localized event. But he comes up with that conclusion because he reads that and he's viewing that through the lens of science. He is an astrophysicist, a brilliant man. Now, friend, I'm not saying that perhaps he's not right. He may be right. I may be wrong. But you know what? When I get to heaven and I'm dead and I'm standing before the Lord and he says, "Craig, you were wrong about my creation account." You know what? I'm not going to lose any sleep over it. I know I'm not, because we won't even be sleeping in heaven, will we? But to me, the whole issue here is, what is our primary resource, our source of authority? He also believes that science has established with absolute certainty the existence of a pre-Adamic hominid. He talks about subhuman creatures who were perfectly manlike in appearance. He states, as a matter of fact, that bipedal, tool-using, large-brain hominids roamed the earth as long as 1 million years ago, long before he believes that Adam ever appeared on the scene. How does he come up with that? By viewing the scripture through the lens of science. And in order to explain how species like that arose and disappeared before Adam's creation, he insists that the world was filled with bloodshed, death, violence, and decay for countless millennia, even prior to the fall of Adam and the curse in Genesis chapter 3. But you see, to me, that presents a serious problem, because it seems to me like Genesis 3, verse 14 through 19 tells us that the result of the curse that occurred because of the fall of man, the result of it was bloodshed, death, violence, and decay. So if that was all here before that happened, then what do we do with Genesis chapter 3, verses 14 through 19? Now, friend, I say all that to say that you've got to determine for yourself how you're going to answer the question, should we appraise Scripture by science, or should we appraise science by Scripture? And I'm just a whole lot more comfortable in choosing the latter. Second question: is general revelation equal to special revelation? Now, what is general revelation? General revelation is the display of divine glory that is evident in creation. That's general revelation, the display of divine glory that is evident in creation. And what do we see in that general revelation? You say we see God. Yeah, but what do we see about God? We see His greatness, we see His majesty, we see His power, we see His glory. That's what we see in general revelation. But what about special revelation? Special revelation is the truth that God has revealed in Scripture. And in His book, Creation and Time, Dr. Ross says that God's revelation is not limited exclusively to the Bible's words. He says the facts of nature may be likened to a 67th book of the Bible, end of quote. Now, to me, that's taking it just a little far. To say that, you know, we could put another book in the canon, and that would be general revelation, what we see of God in nature. And the question for me at this point is simply this: is God's general revelation as essential and as authoritative as special revelation? Is it? Is it as essential? Is it as authoritative? Now, to me, the answer is no. To Dr. Ross and to some old earth creationist, the answer is yes. And it seems that when you read that book that I just quoted from, it seems that he's trying to back away from that statement because he realizes the implications of it. And he said on the following page of the quote I just gave you, he said, some readers might fear that I am implying that God's revelation through nature is somehow on equal footing with his revelation through the words of the Bible. And then he said, let me simply state that truth, by definition, is information that is perfectly free of contradiction and error. Just as it is absurd to speak of some entity as more important than another, so also one revelation of God's truth cannot be held as inferior or superior to another, end of quote. And so by his very own words, what is he saying? He is saying that general revelation and special revelation, they stand on equal footing. That just as God has revealed himself through nature and just as God has revealed himself through the scripture, both of these are the same thing as far as authority and as far as that which is essential. And one of my strongest disagreements with this brilliant man is at that point. He and I differ on the creation account because we differ on our authority. See, friends, his authority is nature and the Bible. My authority is the Bible, just the Bible. Now, I'm not saying that we can't be helped by other resources, but there is absolutely, in my personal opinion, no authority like the authority of the written Word of God. No authority like God's special revelation. And I think that we are treading on thin ice and getting on dangerous ground if we ever begin to take other sources of authority and put them on equal footing with God's Word. He says in the same book, God reveals himself faithfully through the voice of nature as well as through the inspired words of Scripture. Now I agree. God does reveal himself through nature, just like he does through the inspired words of Scripture. But my question is, which is the superior revelation? Which is superior? Friend, what about the truth of the gospel? That's the greatest truth in the Bible, right? That's the greatest truth of all. And what about that truth? Is it discernible to someone who observes only nature and the cosmos apart from Scripture? Can they observe the gospel through that part of God's revelation? What about the blind person who can't see and observe nature nor the cosmos? Well, friend, for that person, there is a superior revelation that they can hear. It's called the words of the Bible. And while I have tried my best to be as complacent or as compliant as I can, there's one statement he makes in that book that I want to tell you just kind of makes the hair stand up on the back of my neck when he says the classic view of a literal six-day creation and a young earth is rooted in a faulty revelational theology. How could that be faulty? I would say, Dr. Ross, as much as I respect you, listen, I think that your view is rooted in a faulty dual revelational theology. You see, we need to look toward a singular revelational theology. That's my personal opinion. And then in support of his view about the idea of general revelation and special revelation being on equal footing, he gives us some verses. And if you read his books, you might come to the conclusion that, you know, if you're a young earther, that you just simply deny general revelation altogether. And that's not true. Friend, I believe in general revelation. I believe in it with all of my heart. But I also believe that general revelation has a legitimate place. And the Word of God puts it in its place. I want to show you two passages. Romans chapter 1, the two passages that he quotes to make his case for general revelation. And the way that he uses that, I believe, to set up everything he believes about creation and the long eras of the creative days. In Romans chapter 1, verse 19, that very familiar text, he says, because that which may be known of God is manifested in them. And he's talking about creation, right? Talking about what we see when we look up into the heavens. That which may be known of God is manifest in them. For God showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they who see these things in my general revelation, they are without excuse. But what is it that Paul says that general revelation reveals about God? He points it out, God's eternal power and his Godhead. General revelation reveals the existence of God. There is a God. To the degree that anybody that rejects that, the Bible says they are without excuse. But Psalm 19, and I want you to look at Psalm 19 with me, because this is a psalm that he uses on many different occasions. And Psalm 19, he quotes verses 1 through 4 and goes to town with these verses to talk about God's general revelation. Now, let me tell you something about Dr. Hugh Ross, one of the most brilliant men who has ever lived. But Dr. Ross is an astrophysicist. He is not a theologian. And I think he makes a serious mistake right here. Because what he does not seem to understand is that you cannot take verses 1 through 4 and separate them contextually from verses 7 through 11 without messing up the text. And I think that's precisely what he does. Notice in verses 1 through 4, these are the verses that he uses to talk about general revelation. He says, the heavens, I'm making this the 67th book of the canon almost, the heavens declare the glory of God, the firmament showeth forth his handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. And isn't that true? Wherever you go in the world, it doesn't matter. Look up in the skies, and what do you see? You see creation shouting, there is a God. Verse 4, their line is gone out throughout all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them hath he set a tabernacle for the sun. General revelation. Everybody can see there is a God by looking at general revelation. That is God's nature. But friend, you can't separate that from verses 7 through 11, because he comes down in verse number 7 and he talks about special revelation. And he said, the law of the Lord, and by the way, all of these words are simply synonyms for the Bible. The law of the Lord is what? It's perfect. Doing what? Converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord, special revelation, is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord, special revelation, are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord, special revelation, is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord, special revelation, is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord, that special revelation, are true and righteous altogether. More they are to be desired than fine gold, yea, than much fine gold. They are sweeter than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them, special revelation, Is thy servant warned? And in keeping of them, special revelation, there is great reward. You see, dear friend, the revelation of God and His glory through nature is so obvious that anyone who looks at nature and rejects God, the Bible says, is without excuse. But is God's revelation in nature enough? And the answer is no. That revelation tells us there is a God, but it doesn't tell us how to know Him. And the whole point of Psalm 19 is not a focus on general revelation being equal to special revelation. The whole focus of Psalm 19 is the sufficiency of Scripture, which is special revelation. And are general revelation and special revelation on equal footing? I hope not. I hope not. Because Jesus said, Matthew 24, verse 35, heaven and earth, general revelation shall pass away, but my words, special revelation, abideth forever. I'm going with special revelation every time. And special revelation and general revelation are not on equal footing. You see, general revelation is sufficient to condemn the sinner, but not sufficient to save him. He needs something more authoritative. He needs special revelation. That's the Scripture. Friend, my question is, if special revelation is sufficient to save us, sustain us, and instruct us, why is it not sufficient to tell us about creation in Genesis chapter 1? If it's sufficient to provide us with everything we need, why is it not sufficient to do that? Friend, I want to tell you, this psalm makes it clear that the revelation of God in nature is not equal to God's revelation in Scripture. The verses tell us it is not as powerful, not as enduring, not as reliable, not as clear, and not as sufficient or authoritative as revelation in Scripture. Scripture speaks with more authority than nature. And it should be used to assess scientific opinion and not the other way around. Friend, listen, it truly is for me an authority issue. That's why I believe what I believe. And I think that Scripture should be the rule by which we measure science, but for many fine Christians who love the Lord, I'm afraid that has been reversed. And for many progressive creationists, scientific theory has become the interpretive grid through which they read and explain Scripture. And they have made science the interpreter of Scripture in a way that, in my opinion, is completely unnecessary. In my opinion, what this has done is oftentimes it's resulted in the actual language of the text being obscured and even overturned, all to fit into a scientific theory. Friend, nowhere should we feel compelled to make the Bible fit a man-made theory. Why are we compelled to do that? We don't have to do that. And we don't have to check our brains at the door to tell somebody why it is that we don't do that. We got a whole bunch of evidence on our side. I just want to close by asking one concluding question. If you were marooned on a desert island and all you had was your Bible, would that be enough for God to reveal to you what He wanted to reveal? Would it be enough? In my opinion, absolutely. The sufficiency of Scripture.